meeting, we're going to hand off to you.
Thanks, Reg. Good morning, everybody. Bonjour, Sego. Just first like to acknowledge that we're meeting today on the territories of Mi'kmaq, the Pétuk, Nausicaa Nations, and all the other nations that have at times called this home. And to really bring greetings from snowy Ottawa. I'm glad that I'm here and not there right now, so this is an extra special day for me to avoid for a few more hours the mess that is all around.
It's extra special weather for us too.
Yes, I heard you broke like 10 records this last week just because I was coming. I'm thrilled.
Don't stay long, we'll be getting
more. Yes, yeah. When I go back, I'm hoping it's like this in Ottawa. So I'm here today to talk about some significant changes at the Canada Council for the Arts. What we think is a major and somewhat radical transformation for an organization that's been that has been around now for 60 years. The Canada Council for the Arts was created by an act of parliament. And our mandate is to foster and promote the study and enjoyment of and production of works in the arts. That's a pretty broad mandate. For a long time, we did it in a very particular way. And I think it's useful, before I get into the changes, to talk about where we came from and how we've been doing things, well, at least for the last 20 years anyway. We are mandated, we are the federal funder for the arts in Canada. So our job is to get money to artists and arts organizations. So if you're going to be part of the federal government, that's the part you want. We give out money. We love it. The Canada Council right now has a budget, an annual budget of $180 million, of which approximately $140 million, a little bit more, goes into direct support of artists and arts organizations across the country. Now, you may have heard also that we've gotten some good news lately. The incoming Liberal government had promised during the election to double the funding of the Canada Council. And as most promises during an election campaign, we took that with a grain of salt. However, the new Minister of Culture and Heritage, Melanie Joly, very quickly, after being appointed to that role, came through. And we are going to have our budget doubled over the next 5 years to a total of $360 million. We are absolutely thrilled about that, and we hope you are as well. The other commitment by the Canada Council of this new funding, 88% of it will be going directly to support for artists and arts organizations. So only 12% will be added to our operational. And that's just for a few new staff. We're not doubling the number of people employed. We're not getting a better building. We just got a nice new building. There's no reason to move. So just rest assured that that money will be coming to you and to like artists and organizations across the country. So I'm here today to talk about how we're going to do that now. One thing to note about the doubling of our budget, it does happen over 5 years. So we're getting incremental increases each year. So we don't get the whole doubling right away. It happens over 5 years, but it is in the budgets. We have seen them, and by 2021, we'll be at the $360 million level. So, how did we fund before? Well, it was a fairly complex process. Started simply enough by a recognition that we needed to support artists and arts organizations across Canada. So the way we fund right now is through six disciplinary sections, okay? Music, theater, dance, visual arts, media arts, writing and publishing, and four multidisciplinary offices. So the Audience and Market Development Office, the InterArts Office, the Equity Office, and the Aboriginal Arts Office, which is what I run right now. And within each one of those funding mechanisms, there were a variety of programs. So you would apply to a program within a disciplinary section or a non-disciplinary office, depending on what you wanted to do. And what happened is that as genres, mediums changed as different kinds of art was being produced, as pressures were put on to expand how we think about the arts, we would just add new programs. To the point where we had these 10 funding mechanisms, offices and sections, and 146 distinct programs within those. So we just, if there was a new field of practice, we would just add a new program. If there were artists that had been marginalized or hadn't had access to our funding in the past, we would add a new program or a new office. That's how the Aboriginal Arts was created. The Equity Office was created, the Inter-Arts, because it was like, what do we do with hybrid practices that don't fall into any of these disciplinary sections? Let's add a program, let's add an office. As you might guess, that becomes unsustainable at a certain point. You just can't keep doing that. Plus, it became very complex for people to actually apply. So if you didn't know what it is you wanted, you had to search around and then figure out what it was you wanted, what program might fit you, and then figure out how to apply. And so for the last 6 or 7 years, we've been recognizing this, and a movement was started to say, this has to end. We just can't do this anymore. It's unsustainable, and it's getting more and more difficult for people to actually do what it is they want to do. And they spend a lot of time trying to figure out how to get money from us. So when our new CEO, Simon Bro, came on board just under 3 years ago, his first act was to say, we must transform. And if we're going to transform, we have to transform everything. Not just how we do things, but why we do them. To really reinvestigate how we actually articulate the mandate that we're given by the government. So, from all this 10 mechanisms, 146 programs, we now have, or will, because this starts in April 1st, this comes into effect. Right now we're in status quo. So all the funding that you might already be used to is still there. All the programs exist. Take advantage of them. They're still running. April 1st, everything changes. To 6 major national programs. Okay? These are the big funding mechanisms now. They will be the only ones we will not be adding them. This is what we've got. They are non-disciplinary in nature. So they encompass all the disciplines in each one of them. With a total of 30 components in each one, or 30 components total. So each one has a different number of components. I'll go through them all. Again, that won't change because we've made them very flexible and responsive so that if there's new practices, we don't have to create a new section, and we'll get that as we move along. We also have committed to a renewal and a reinvigoration of the relationship with First Nations, Inuit, and Métis artists, organizations, and communities. We take very seriously our responsibility as an arm of the federal government in maintaining and also bettering that relationship. When I talk about the new Indigenous program, I'll talk a bit more about that. It's an outcomes-based model now. So every program and every has a set of outcomes that it is trying to achieve. And so everything that we do will be based on those outcomes. We'll get into that a bit more. We also are reaffirming our commitment to equity practices so that we reflect the nation as a whole. And we make sure that we have not created a model that excludes. So it's a very inclusive model. And we have a new online portal. This is really important because this is your access point to the Canada Council. And it's an online registration system. So it will open on December 1st of this year. So you have 4 months before we go in. The portal allows you access. And what you do in the portal is set up what we call a profile or number of profiles, depending on what kind of artist or organization you are and what you want to do. So when you register in the portal, you identify your arts practice or your organization's mandate, where you are. You can upload a CV if you're an artist, or organizations, you can upload all your documentation. So you only have to do this once. You don't have to do it every time you apply. It's always there. It's personalized to you, and that becomes your access. Once you register in the portal, it's a pretty easy process, we hope. The testers have told us it's pretty easy. It works for me. So once you do that, then the system will generate an email to you saying, yes, you are now registered, and then it'll go through a validation process. And what that means is that the information that you provide will be validated by a program officer who has expertise in the discipline or disciplines that you have chosen, just to say, yep, this is what they do, perfect. They've done this right, this matches up with the kind of work they do, we're good. Once you're validated in the portal, it will then, based on your profile, tell you which programs and components you're eligible for. And so you'll have a little dashboard. Every time you come in, you'll log in, and it'll say, okay, here's my profile for profiles. Here's all the components that I'm eligible to. And if it tells you when the next deadline is, and if you want to apply, you would just then click on that, and it would take you directly to the application process. The portal will open on December 1st as well. There will be full guidelines for all the programs and components available on December 1st as well. So all the information that you need will be there for you. If you have any questions, we'll also have a telephone line to information officers and program officers, as well as technical help, 24-hour technical line. And if you are having any trouble getting in or just need help filling in the online forms. So everything will be moving to an online basis, the registration in the portal and applications. Now, if for some reason you cannot access that because you're in a remote area, you don't have internet, the paper-based applications will still be available. So again, making sure that nobody gets left out for those kinds of reasons. You must register in the portal at least 30 days before your first application. We suggest that you do it, you know, sometime in the next 4 months, because as I say, once you're in, you're in. You don't have to register every time 30 days before. Once you're registered, you can wait till the day of the deadline to put your application in if you want. You don't have to. You've already been validated. That means you're already eligible for the things that you, or the components that you will be applying to. So you know, this is what is available to me. Now, you can set up more than one profile. So you may have several practices. So you would set up as a dance artist, as a musician, you would have separate profiles. Now, they may go to the same components, but this way you can really have a multidisciplinary practice. And it acknowledges that you have expertise in those. Okay, what will stay the same is our commitment to supporting artistic excellence. Not using that term in a way that I think it has been used in the past to marginalize and exclude, but that we really want to support and encourage artistic practice across the country. And we will still base it on the peer assessment system, which is the two foundational elements of the Canada Council for the Arts are, one, our arm's length relationship to government, which means, yes, we are a part of the federal government, but we are a crown corporation with a parliamentary mandate. That means we are not under direct ministerial control. We get our allotment from parliament every year. We have our own board of directors. We are attached to the Ministry of Culture and Heritage, but we do not report to them. So they have no control over who we give grants to. And that's the arm's length relationship. And the other is the peer assessment system. And It's not a perfect system, but it is the best system I think that you can have, because we do not decide who gets grants. The program officers, directors do not decide that. It's decided by peers. And that means artists and art professionals that we bring together to assess applications and to rank applications and to help us decide who gets grant funding. Many of you may have already been on juries. We will be expanding that pool. Now, when you do register in the portal, you'll also have an opportunity to click a box that says, I would like to be considered to be a peer assessor, at which point, once you're validated, you would also go into that pool. So if you haven't been in that in the past, I would encourage you to sign up for that, because it's the way that we maintain that assessment, so it's not by a small group of people, it is indeed by a wide section of the populace. We are committed to respecting and promoting Indigenous arts, Canada's official languages, practices that reflect cultural, ethnic, and regional diversity, and deaf and disability arts, which we've now added as a field of practice. That is how you identify your practice. That is now a field of practice in itself. Okay, the grant types. It's a little simpler than it used to be. We have project grants, which are just exactly what they sound like. Composite grants, which are project grants, but they're a little bit more complex for larger, not necessarily large, but more complex projects that may take over several years, and they can be done in phases. So that's a new area. Core grants, what we used to call our operating grants. So this is for organizations, and that's, we go into core grants now. And one brand new type of grant, and that's a micro grant, or what we call small scale activities, that is only in the Indigenous program. It may expand to the other ones. This is a bit of a test on it. And these are small, in the case of the Indigenous arts, up to $3,000 grants, not project-based. They're very easy, quick to get. They can be for materials. They can be for doing a workshop, getting some knowledge, paying somebody for some very specific expertise. Again, they're smaller, easier to apply for, they're a very quick turnaround, and we've seen in other councils where these micro grants can be really effectively used by artists. The six programs: Explore and Create, which is program one, Engage and Sustain, we have all cool funky names for all modern programs, Supporting Artistic Practice, Arts Across Canada, Arts Abroad, and the Indigenous program, Creating, Knowing, and Sharing, the Arts and Cultures of First Nations, Inuit, and Métis Peoples. Now, what's interesting about this is the first five programs are complementary in nature, which means they all fund different areas of activity. You may be in one or more of those programs, depending on your profile. So, and I'll get into this a little later. So you might be an artist who applies to Explore and Create, which is the main production program, as well as a few other things. If you've got a project, you're creating a new work of art, you'll go to Explore and Create, no matter what discipline you're in, no matter what your field of practice is. But then maybe you want to tour it. Say it's a theater piece, you want to tour it in Canada. Then you would go to Arts Across Canada, because that's what that program does. Or, I have an opportunity to go international. That'll be Arts Abroad. And I'll go into each one a little later. So they're all complementary that way. The sixth one is a little different. Creating, Knowing, and Sharing. That's the Indigenous program. This is a comprehensive program. So it funds everything that the other five do, but in one program. And there's some unique characteristics to that one based on a differing cosmology and epistemology of Indigenous knowledge transfer, and artistic and cultural practice. So there is some differences about that one but it does fund all the other ones. So there's five complementary, and then creating ownership comprehensive. Okay, explore and create. This is the big one. As I said, this is the main production program. So it supports artists, groups, and organizations to explore new ideas, share innovative works, engage new audiences. You can go there for professional development, various parts of the creative process, and new ways of working. The director of that program will be Caroline Lussier, who's currently the head of the dance section. Now, it has four components. Professional development for artists, which is exactly what it sounds like. Research and creation. This is a production program, but it also acknowledges kind of some of the pre-production. So if you're just doing research for a project, or if you're in the early stages of development, that's a component you would go to. Concept realization is the big project program. If you have a project, you know what you want to do, this is how it's going to go, this is what the end product is going to be, you go to concept realization. Obviously they have bigger grant limits, things like that, whereas you get in research and creation, get a bit smaller grants, but it's definitely in that kind of exploratory phase. But concept realization is the big project program. And then artist-driven organizations, which is the core funding for Explore and Create. So this would be organizations that are led creatively by an artist or a small team. A good example, for example, would be a dance company, because this is for production-based organizations that actually create new works of art. So a dance company led by, usually by a single person who has the artistic and creative drive of that. And they would go there for their core funding. Professional development, like I said, specialist training, internships, workshops, multidisciplinary, anybody who is in a profile as an artist can apply to this for assistance in professional development. Again, research and creation, the project development, you can do residencies, things like that through that program. And concept to realization, productions that result in public presentation, so yeah, there has to be an end goal to it, whereas the other one can be a little bit more exploratory. And then artist-driven organizations. And for the core, the expectation is that you would come to whichever core component, because there are several, and that would cover all of your activities. So you don't have to, if you're on core, you should be getting money for staff, for programming, for research, all of that, three for one. Now, there are opportunities for core organizations to apply for projects, and there's criteria around that, but it should be for exceptional projects, things that would not be considered for your regular programming. Engage and sustain. This program is only for organizations. It is A, for very large organizations. They're seen in a different stream than other organizations, or that organizations that have significant outreach and impact from the perspective of the art form they choose to advance. So it's a very unique kind of organization that within the cultural ecosystem, this is the program that they would go to. And the director of that program will be Amey Dantene, who's currently the head of the music section. It only has two components, artistic catalysts and artistic institutions. They're both core funding. Artistic institutions are organizations that focus on artistic leadership and civic responsibility and that have annual revenues of more than $2 million. Okay? That's where all the big orgs go. Artistic catalysts are organizations that have an ongoing contribution to artistic practice and strengthen the cultural life of communities. Again, we've kept some of these definitions quite open and wide so that we provide the flexibility. If you're not sure if your organization fits in here or not, you just ask. And If you do, then that would be your core. If it's a different kind of organization, we'll get into some of those later on, you go into one of the other core. The commitment by the council is that everybody currently receiving operating funding will continue to receive operating funding. There is a place for you in one of these core programs somewhere, because four of the programs have core funding components. That is the commitment, and you will be moved into the component that best fits you. Okay. Supporting artistic practice. This program encourages a dynamic support system for the arts in Canada. These are organizations and individuals who support, as the name implies, artistic practice. So organizations in this area would be publishers, for example. They support, they're not creation-based themselves. Media arts production centers would fall into that. They support artistic practice, they don't create. Certain artist-run centers and galleries would fall into this as well, depending on the programming. Art service organizations fit into this program. It has six components. Professional development for arts professionals, as opposed to artists. So this could be managers, agents, editors. So if you're an arts professional, this is the one you're trying to do. Sector innovation and development, I'll get into that a bit later. Literary publishing projects, very simple. Literary publishers core funding, well, that's where you would go if you're a publisher. Support organizations for funding. Again, this is where the Media Arts Production Center would go. And National Arts Service Organizations. I'll kind of go through these a little quickly because I think I've sort of talked about this, but I'll talk about the sector innovation and development. This is for groups and organizations as well as arts professionals from designated equity groups, what we call cultural connectors. And this is for projects that strengthen the professional arts sectors. Okay, it's a little bit different than projects that were either creation or presentation based. This is how we develop the sectors, the projects that are concerned with that as their main mandate. So that you're not seen in the same way as an artist who has a creation production project and a sector development, which are very, very different things. So we look at them differently. Literary, I think, is fairly clear. Arts Across Canada. This program supports activities that help artists bring their work to the public and leading more Canadians to appreciate and engage in the arts. Activities can be around developing networks for domestic markets, and that foster artistic partnerships and collaborations. So there's seven components in this. Travel, just what it says. Travel will get easier to apply for now. There will be a tool when you apply for travel. You plug in where you're coming from, where you're going to. It will generate an amount, so you don't have to do the fooling around on the Air Canada website to try to figure out how much it's going to cost you. That will be generated by us. If the cost does go up in the meantime, that would just change and you would just get more money. Representation and promotion. Representation and promotion, exactly what it sounds like. You represent or promote artists or artistic creation. That would be your area. Translation. If you want to translate anything into either English, French, or an indigenous language, you can apply to that component. Circulation and touring in Canada, nationally. So if you're touring circulating any kind of artworks, that would be the place. Foreign artist tours, that's for bringing foreign artists into Canada. Public outreach. And then the core funding in this program is for arts festivals and presenters. There we go. again, all of this information, as well as the full guidelines, will be available on our website beginning December 1st. Yeah, representation, promotion, yeah, travel for developing markets, participating in significant events, or exploring future collaborations. So it can be very exploratory, but if you represent or promote artists or art, that's really nice. Arts abroad. Basically, it's very similar to Arts Across Canada, but it's our international program. And it has six components. This is this does not have a core component. So travel, representation, and promotion, same as arts in Canada, except internationally. The translation is to translate works from English, French, or an indigenous language into a language, an international, a foreign language. Circulation and touring, same, as long as it's international, this is where you go. Also a program for international residencies. If you want to take part in a residency outside of Canada, this would be the area. And co-productions, if you're engaging in a co-production with an international artist or organization, you can come directly to that component. And again, much the same as Arts in Canada, except it's international. Okay, I'm going to go through this one fairly quickly because we're doing a session this afternoon. Anybody who wants to know more about this program, which is Creating, Knowing, and Sharing the Arts and Cultures of First Nations, Inuit, and Métis Peoples. I think this is probably the most significant part of the transformation at Canada Council. What we did is we went on a three-year process, a consultation process, an evaluation process of our history of funding for Indigenous arts and organizations in Canada. And we recognized that in order to really acknowledge and honor the nation-to-nation relationship that this government and some in the past have determined, and for the first peoples of this land, that we needed to create a program that was specific, culturally specific, and that had as its foundation the notions of self-determination and cultural sovereignty. And that by creating that kind of a program, then we honor that relationship by creating an Indigenous space within the Canada Council. So it's guided by Indigenous objectives and values. It's run by a staff of Indigenous peoples. It's assessed by Indigenous arts professionals through our peer assessment is of all Indigenous. And it will be assessed and reported based on outcomes that were created from an Indigenous worldview and perspective. One of the differences in this program is that we have a wider applicant base, so yes, artists, but we also support aspiring artists who are working with a mentor, cultural carriers, those are people whose role within their community or the larger Indigenous community is the maintenance and transference of cultural and aesthetic knowledge. So this could be traditional knowledge keepers, elders, storytellers, who may or may not see themselves in the kind of professional artist way that we do for our other programs. Also cultural professionals. This would include scholars, researchers, agents, managers, producers, and Indigenous arts organizations. That's the core element of this particular program. The components of Creating, Knowing, Sharing are, as I said, the small-scale activities, very easy to apply for. You can get up to $3,000. You just need some materials. You don't have to have a project. Travel grants, travel grants will be much easier to apply for in the new model all across the programs. And they're less prescriptive. We used to have a lot of things you had to do to get travel grants at Canada Council. It was a little bizarre, actually. Now it's much more open. So you determine what the travel is that you need to advance your career. It's not up to us to say it has to be this, or it has to be this, or it has to be this. We're moving away from that particular model. In CPS, we have short-term grants, which are up to a year long, and these are projects, and then long-term project-based grants, which you can go over 3 years. And then, as I said, Indigenous organizations. I'll save that for this afternoon. Okay, this is a little map. So basically, we are now at the second to last, which is December, when the online portal will open for profile registration. And then in April of 2017, the first program deadline. The deadlines are already on our website, but as I say, once the portal opens, there'll be a lot more information. Every one of the new programs will have project components. It will have a deadline either in April or May. So we want to get you in and get you some money right away. The various core programs, if you are on operating now, if you haven't already heard from the section that you're currently in, you will very soon, to tell you how that transition will be made. We are absolutely committed to not creating gaps in funding. So if necessary, we would just carry over funding. If this was the end of one of your cycles and you would normally apply this fall, you don't have to. You'll just get carried over. You get the same amount that you got last year. Our strategic plans, we've just completed our new 5-year strategic plan, which also matches up with, as I said, the increases in our funding over the next 5 years, and it also speaks to where we see the council going through the new funding model, but also moving forward. So the commitments in our strategic plan are to increase our support to artists, collectives, and organizations, and we'll do that by putting more money in. So that's an easy one for us to do, because we happen to have some extra money just sitting around there. Amplify the quality, scale, and sharing of Canadian art through digital technology. You may have heard that we are planning a major symposium conference on arts in a digital age, not digital arts, but how the arts are impacted, affected, and will be affecting digital culture. Certainly, it's an area we all know has had profound impacts on artistic communities and cultural communities, and we really want to position ourselves to be able to respond to artists and organizations as they work through that. Some of that will be very pragmatic. Some you just need to do some things to make sure that you know you're keeping up with the changes in the digital environment. Some will be, well, how do we fund things? You know, what is this? There's some really interesting kind of gray areas right now about what is art, what is not art. So how do we respond to make sure that we are facilitating you as the creators as you work through a new digital landscape? To renew and revitalize the relationship between Indigenous artists and Indigenous and non-Indigenous audiences for a shared future. I can talk about that all day. And to raise the international profile of Canadian art and arts, so we have a renewed commitment to engaging in international activities. It has been problematic in the past. It was difficult for artists and organizations to access money to do work internationally. We've made it a lot easier, most significantly through the Arts Abroad program, so that that's where you go if you want to engage in that. We encourage it. And like I said, having new resources really helps us do that. We'll also be doing some strategic work internationally. For example, in the Indigenous program, we're sending delegations to various significant events, and also to network and gather with Indigenous groups from all over the world. So it's a specific kind of strategic role we'll be playing. The other programs will also be doing strategic initiatives in order to either, depending on which program it is, but depending on the outcomes, to really be a proactive, not just a reactive funder. And I think that that's one of the things that differentiates us going into the future. questions after. That's my thank you. I do want to talk about this idea of the reactive and the proactive now for a bit, because I think it's, again, fundamental to the relationship that the Canada Council wants to have with the arts ecosystem in Canada. We've gotten to a point, because of that 146 programs and all the challenges that come with that, I think we become a bit of an ATM, right? You put in your card, and you put in your code, and if it was the right one, and you had funds in there, it just spit out money to you. And that's okay. There's nothing wrong with that. Like I said, our job is to get money into the arts ecosystem. And one way to do that is just to directly to artists and arts organizations. But if we're going to transform ourselves and see ourselves as part of that arts ecosystem, and I think we're a very important part of that arts ecosystem, as is the Newfoundland and Labrador Arts Council, as is the Ontario Arts Council, the Alberta Foundation for the Arts, and all the other councils, we are part of this system. We have to be proactive in that way, but not prescriptive. It's not up to us to tell you what to do. That's not our job. Our job is to foster and help create a robust arts infrastructure, ecosystem, and cultural ecology across the entire land. And we do that by, yes, getting money up to you, making it easier for you to apply, and also widening the base of people who can come to us. We must reflect the entire nation state, the demographics, the regionality, differing histories, differing social realities, differing funding dynamics across the country. We know that they're different. Different geographical issues. We have to be part of that. And these programs give us that flexibility. They also allow us to be much more strategic. That does not mean that the grant system will change. So that doesn't mean that, oh, we're not getting enough applicants from this particular place, so let's just take the ones that are in there and just give them money. No, that's not what it means. That peer assessment process is so much part of what we do. But it does mean that we can actively work to encourage, engage not only artists and organizations, but the audiences that support them. And through that, really take a look at where there may be disparities and actively work to alleviate that as much as possible. But that, again, is done in collaboration, in partnership with our funding agency partners, but also with the artists and organizations. You are why we do what we do. Very clearly, that will not change. We are a facilitator. We have the resources. We're very lucky we have extra resources right now. We understand completely that that's not true of all the parties in Canada. We understand that we're going to have to pick up some of that slack as well. And we take that very seriously. And we're working very closely with our partners. We also know that we have to engage directly with you as much as we can. So people like me get to travel a fair bit for the next few months and meet as many people as we can. And we're also going to be coordinating gatherings, symposia, so that we can take a wide-ranging look at the Canadian cultural ecology and see our positionality within it. So I'll be happy to answer any questions after. I can get into more details. I have the guidelines with me. Nobody else has seen them yet, except our little gang at Canada Council. I do have them with me, so because I don't know all the programs spot on, like I know the one that I'll be in charge of, but we can get into some of those details, but we'll turn the camera off now. All right, thank you very much.